for sword. This 714 one-handed.
Carry this.
Bless you.
What little help I can offer is yours. Surviving in Rayclast is a simple matter. Don't be curious. Most exiles test fate, braving the coasts in hopes of taking Prisoner's Gate, the greener pastures. None have returned. Perhaps they were right, or perhaps their lives were dashed as quickly as their hopes.
Thank you.
Can I help?
Good job, Maddie. You didn't succumb to pressure. Allie, it's so close. I mean, so loud.
Hello.
So, we're waiting for the bus to come. I'm having a lollipop and sitting on this ball. And the bus will be coming soon, but it's a long drive. It's 1 hour.
Huh? Okay. Crazy girls. Ooh, wait on.
Hi
yes.
Guys, it's Freddy.
Okay, well, we'll see you when we're there.
Bye. Eight. I am warrior. Warrior, man. Warrior.
Hang on. Wait a second.
What are you doing?
Batman.
Sensor, maybe. The sensor. Because it's electronic. So. I work today. At home! That's good. I need to work. You know what I'm
The earth of Rayclast rejects the dead. The black spirit of storm and dream now reaches into the ground and raises up our slain imperial foes. It leads the fallen from their graves and drives them to fight us beyond the end, rotted tooth and jagged nail. Our own remembered have joined their cursed ranks. No longer may we give our beloved to the birds, messengers of spirit to the sky, conveyors of flesh to the earth. Calm has commanded us to destroy our remembered with axe and fire. Calm is the bravest of us, willing to bear the ire of the ancestors for the survival of his people.
When bones walk, they are not Karui. Carry this.
I Tala Moana, warrior. Tala Moana, warrior.
Thank you.
I cannot carry this. I cannot carry this. carry this.
Thank you for freeing me. The Mother of Death likes to play these little tricks on me, to remind me of my place. But she also sent you here to help. Let me return the favor, Exile. We will meet again in town, and then I will help you illuminate your path.
A slave is not a man. A slave is not even worthy of death.
It's told that Brutus was a man of stature, the warden of Axiom Prison. A man cursed by a twisted enchantment of his own commission. If there's a grain of truth to the tale, then Brutus has my pity. Have this. It may be of some help. Don't tell Tarkley, but they're the foulest fowl I've ever tasted. Still, exiles can't be choosers.
Hi, John. Good. Your mom's here. Just letting you know, but I don't know. Say it, Bane.
made any progress. One day we'll be strong enough to make our way inland, build new lives on the carcass of a dead empire. It's why God sent us maggots here, isn't it?
Okay, you want.
What now?
Hello.
TV! TV's on tomorrow. Yeah, you're coming, John. We're leaving early in the morning, like 3. Okay? Yeah, and you'll just go to sleep. Yeah?
I said 5.
Last day, eh, John? Yeah, today, John. We're leaving today. We're late.
So early.
You'll be right, John. It's a bush, John. Huh? Oh, she knows where we're gonna be sleeping. It's gonna be up the hill. Ah, there's snakes everywhere. And dingoes. No water, no toilet, no TV. Oh yeah, I'm bringing a shovel.
We have a bush tabby. So on top of the hole, there is a
Yeah, we'll have a toilet so you can sit on it.
Is it choice that carries you here, or is it fate? I see a need in you. A need to peer into your future. A need to follow the right path. But your future has already been cast. So open your mind and embrace it. Long ago, my people called me a Hatungo, a wise woman. Now they call me a revenant. But it is not my fate to return to the Mother of Death just yet. For now, I stand with one foot in this world, and the other foot in the realm of the dead. I'm an inquirer of the living, and an interpreter of death. I sense you have questions. For a gift of silver, I will answer them. But you seek more than answers. Riches. Power. These I can also provide, in a way. All you have to do is join me. Heed my words, but walk your path. The future is mine to tell, but yours to claim. It is time to fulfill your prophecy. The cold blusters from above, chilling the unwary to the bone.
There's a fine line between man and monster. Brutus, he well and truly crossed that line. Brutus is a big lad, and as you know from Hillock, big lads are slow. Hit and run. That's the way to cut them down to size. Unless there's magic involved. Then, I'd ask Nessa to light a candle in your memory.
hello. I traveled here through death's darkened halls, walking the paths of the remembered. I am but a memory of the woman I was. A memory treasured and sustained by the Mother of Death. I awoke in the halls of death, with the life I once led little more than a dream half remembered. Yama the White, my furry companion, stood before me with the seeing stone he holds now. Both were given a hair of Hinekora's dark knowledge, but each serves a separate purpose. The seeing stone drags me deep into its core, where every instant into eternity is known all at once, like limitless rings on a tree trunk. Yama, like a torch in the mist, guides me back from the stone's infinite visions. Hinekora, my mother of death, is not the only god, exile. The Karui are watched over by many. Namahu lends us fire, which illuminates the path. Tafua gives us the trees and birds that line the path, so that we may enjoy beauty and peace. Tukohama provides us with weapons and knowledge of war, which lets us walk the path safely. And in the final days of this world, Kitava, whose hunger knows no bounds, will take it all away.
First moment that I realized I wanted to do this.
was the day where I, as a young boy, along with millions and millions of people around the globe, watched those first footsteps on the moon. I realized that humanity had just become a different species. We were no longer a species confined to our planet. That's what I wanted to do. I wanted to be part of that exploration. I wanted to be part of that group of people that stepped off the planet and was able to look back upon ourselves.
As a child, I assumed that I would go into space. We were trying to get to the moon, the whole Apollo program, and it seemed like we had this momentum moving forward. And I assumed I would be a part of it.
The first time I went into space was 2008 for the official Discovery. It was really uncomfortable to go into space. I remember leaving the crew quarters, boarding the astro van, and waving to everybody as we stepped out. And we get out to the launch pad. It was really a spectacular sight. And we launch the spacecraft on Tuesday. It looks like just yellowish white smoke, and eventually this spaceship just slowly gradually rises out of the smoke and opens up. And what it felt like is it felt like we were on the end of a slingshot. When those solid rocket boosts were firing, you realize you were going somewhere. That somebody just let go of that slingshot and off you go. That was a really amazing experience. And that first day in space, the most spectacular moment was when you look out the window for the first time. When you are able to unstrap out of your seat, your tasks are over and you get to really take a look. And our planet is just absolutely breathtaking.
It's just an incredible view. I look down at this planet, at our Earth, and you see this shimmering layer of light. That's our atmosphere that sustains us. It almost seems like an iridescence.
What's really amazing and beautiful is watching this line slowly pass across the Earth below us. Something that you can't see from here. Watching all the evidence coming out of the Earth all of a sudden as we pass it to the dark side of the Earth. We flew so close to the dancing winds of the worlds that we felt like we were going to reach out. Third spacewalk that we did, I was strapped to the end of the space station's robotic arm. And it was flying through a big maneuver across the top of the space station. So at the top of this arm, I was looking down at the space station against the backdrop of on the cloud of the beautiful Earth 250. I was filled with awe. It
we can do this, if nations can join together and do this amazing thing in space, imagine what we can do to overcome the challenges facing our planet. The other side of that is we have this incredibly beautiful, peaceful, fragile planet from space. But you can't help but think about the unfortunate realities of life on our planet. There's some really unfortunate things.
The real issue is how do we operate here on this planet? There's a story that comes from India that says that once upon a time, humans had a godhead in themselves. But we behaved so badly that the gods decided to take it away from us. And so they were trying to figure out where to hide it so that humans wouldn't find it. One said, let's put it at the bottom of the ocean. They'll never find it there. And everybody said, you know, one day humans will get to the bottom of the ocean and they'll find it. Another said, let's put it in the skies, in the heavens. And they said, no, humans will fly that far one day and they'll find it. And then Brahma said, I know where to hide it. Let's put it inside of humans themselves. We have to look inside of ourselves to figure this out.
One of the truly extraordinary events of the 20th century was space travel. And by that, I don't simply mean the fact that we went to the moon and came back, but that this gave us a totally different perspective on the Earth. A totally different understanding about who we are.
The history of human life on the planet, in one sense, is a history of wandering, a history of leaving home. Humans spread out of Africa to eventually inhabit every continent of the planet. In that sense, humans became planetary 40,000 years ago, but we didn't know that they existed on the planet. Apollo mission, we had a kind of visceral experience. Individuals were able to see the whole planet in space. And through our technology, the rest of us could see it.
The first time we got that picture of the Earth, we were seeing our own planet constant. No longer, house we lived in or the village or the country, suddenly we were seeing this is home in a much larger context. It became a symbol for many, many things, environmental movements, global thinking. In the past, we had individual, community, national destinies. The one thing that it did for me was it brought home that we are one species on a single planet with a common destiny.
Identify ourselves as part of the human species, that's really the identity shift, right? Ourselves as a single species on this planet. We realized that there was a subset of the teeming life on that planet called humans, and that we were far enough away to be humans. almost see us as one people, as one population.
I spent half of 2011 on board the International Space Station. And during that time, I got into a routine where I would almost say goodnight to the Earth. I would go to the cooker, the window that was over there at the bottom of the space station, and I would just gaze at it. One of the really interesting things about a long-duration space flight is you get to watch the Earth transform over the weeks and the months that you're up there. You get to watch the ice break up, the seasons change, and from that perspective, the perspective over time, you really get the sense that we have this living, breathing organism hanging in the blackness of space that's riding through the universe.
Very early on, the astronauts looked at the whole of Earth and the feeling came with one single living system. I think that was part of the shift that happened. And it's interesting that we're doing it at the same time as Jim Lovelock was thinking about the idea that all the different creatures, the oceans, atmosphere, soil, were sort of working together. Throughout the history of life on Earth, we had kept the proper conditions being used to continue. We looked at the Earth and saw that this is exactly what happened. So he put forward the idea that the whole planet is like one single living system.
You imagine the famous Earth Rise project. His first images of the Earth. The Apollo missions were taken from space. We normally think of it as an astronaut in a spaceship looking from outside of Earth at the Earth. More fundamentally,
I cannot carry this.
These images are the Earth looking at itself through us. In other words, the first images of space, a critical moment in the emerging awakening of the Earth. So we look at those first images that came back from space. It's important for us to understand that those are as out of date now as my high school yearbook picture is. I mean, you look at the summer Arctic and there's 40% less ice. Clearly, the basic, most fundamental physical problem that we face is this exploding fountain of carbon into the atmosphere, warming the planet. And that comes from the fact that fossil fuel radically transformed our set of possibilities beginning 300 years ago.
We're at the point where we know that humans have impacted the planet. That was something that we didn't think about, you know, 200, 300 years ago. We weren't having that kind of impact. We know we can affect the world.
We are traversing a terrain which we as a species and as a planet overall have not seen before. We are facing an ecological crisis that has the capacity to tremendously alter life on Earth. We don't know what will happen if major parts of the web of life disappear.
every species that exists on the planet has been coaxed into existence over the 4.4 billion year history of the Earth. So literally, it's taken the entire history of cosmic evolution to bring forth the diversity and complexity of the biosphere that we have now.
When I look back on my life, there were certain crucial moments that changed me forever. One of them was the discovery that we are in the midst of a mass extinction. At the present time, there are perhaps 10 million species. And species come and go. But in mass extinction moments, species begin to be extinguished in droves. In our moment, thousands of species are disappearing every year. Back in the 1980s, there was a conference at the Smithsonian, and they make an announcement that we were in the middle of this mass extinction. That, quite simply, there had never been a moment more destructive in the last 65 million years than our moment. I mean, it was just so colossal, so depressing. And so I couldn't sleep that night. I don't know what to do. It really affected me. The next morning, I went out and I bought the New York Times, and the announcement of this mass extinction was on page 26 of the New York Times. So that means that we humans found 25 pages of news items more important than the elimination of life on the planet Earth. In that moment, I realized that something was wrong with our human civilization for eliminating life, for our media for not reporting it and then forgetting about it, for our political system for not doing something about it.
What is it that pulls our awareness away from sitting with the pain of what we have done? Of what we've done and been doing to
history, every culture organizes itself around the fundamental story. We can pretend we're living without a story, but if we stop and really think about it and ask ourselves, what's the way in which I organize my life? How do I find meaning in my day-to-day life? You'll start to see the most essential organizing part in the human experience.
Ever since we really took place, we've been asking ourselves fundamental questions. Where do we come from? What are we doing? What is life in this universe all about? And up with
with some pretty fantastic stories, which is a big question. Everything else, and humans became so arrogant that we believed the universe was made just for us. For the education and liberation of our individual souls. That somehow we weren't connected. We were specially created. We were separate from all of us.
I cannot carry this.
Those are totally dysfunctional stories.
In some absolute sense, but it's just one model of reality. The interesting thing is not to say who's right and who's wrong, but to look at how different belief systems mediate the relationship between humanity and the natural world with profoundly different consequences in terms of the ecological system.
That we're superior to nature, that we walk around on top of nature. When we look at our politics, we look at our economics, we see that they're based on the separation between us and earth. I think that sense of alienation has led us to desecration.
Every culture that we keep has. We all have a place that we come from, we all have our ways. We all have our practices. We all have our creation stories, our cosmologies. The worldview that we currently exist in as the dominant paradigm places human beings above all else. It views the rest of the planet. Use all other beings as resources that are to be acquired, resources that are to be used. And for that worldview to continue to persist and to thrive, it has to ignore the destruction. In fact, it has to put us all to sleep. Because if this worldview were to face the truth of what we do, put into motion, it would collapse upon itself.
If we look at the ecological crisis and if we look at the economic crisis, I think we can
see this
as rooted in those stories that you've got to keep growing, keep expanding. Because if you don't do it, somebody else will. There are pressures to keep this economic juggernaut moving. All, I think, based upon this ultimate story, you know, economic growth and success. What we're doing, it seems to me, is trying to control the conditions of our existence on this earth, trying to mold everything into a resource that we can use. Given this obsession with never-ending economic and technological growth, it seems inevitable that sooner or later we're going to bump up against the limits of the biosphere of the planet. And it seems like it's starting to happen now.
There has to be a part of us that knows the Earth is in pain. That what brought us forth is in some sense dying. And our mainstream narrative, it's to allow us to feel numb to cut us off from that inherent intuitive sense that something is really wrong in how we're relating to this only home of ours.
One of the problems that we face is that we haven't done a very good job of remembering what makes us human and what makes us happy. The average American is significantly less happy on surveys than they were 50 or 60 years ago, even though our standard of living has theoretically trebled over that time. And the reason is that we've gotten out of touch with each other. Americans spent the last 50 years embarked on the project of building bigger houses farther apart from each other. That has had not only huge environmental consequences, you have to heat and cool and drive between these places. It's also had deep social consequences. You run into people a lot less. The average American has half as many close friends as they would have 50 years ago. That's a very big change for a socially evolved primate.
If we were to walk down the street and ask somebody in a way that went straight to their hearts, what is it that you want? They would say, so far, you've cut yourself off from everything, and you've created a landscape just for the moment.
I'm racing to airports, I'm racing to meetings, I'm racing through email. I am racing through my life, but not necessarily living.
The greatest wound of modernity is the idea that we are other than life, or that nature is other than us.
Yokohama.
And we
I cannot
were
carry
brought
this.
Up thinking that we're in classrooms cut off from nature, looking outside the window at it and studying it in textbooks. Our upbringing, you know, houses and the way we dressed and the way we lived and the way we cut ourselves off, you know, was as if nature was out there, a threat, not very friendly. That wound, that deep, deep wound is such a loss. You know.
Hello. A lot of people. If they see grass in the crack of the sidewalk, that may be the only other living thing that they see hour upon hour. You know, and most of us live in cities now and are very separate, it becomes easy to forget that you're kin with a living planet, that you're part of a living planet, you know, when you don't see it much. It's as if we're living in a museum, you know, curated by someone who's decided to not let any natural objects in for some reason, right? It doesn't take much to go back into the natural world and go, oh, now I remember. I work with people all day long, and I bring them outside. I watch them eventually get back in touch with their evolutionary kin, you know, they're back in a natural setting. It's like putting water in a dry plant. At a certain point, being in that natural setting, when we talk about are you separate from nature, of course they say no. No, of course not. No, I'm back home. But, you know, 40 hours from now, you know, they're in their cube and they get on their elevator and they go down to the subway and they get on a tube and travel. And of course there's that disconnection.
Either a human being or a social system to change, the old system has to stop working. Life as usual has to stop working. Normal has to become unsustainable. Everything that has worked for hundreds of years, our way of looking at the world, the ideology of growth, of mastering nature, of conquering nature, the technologies of control, all of these things are coming into question. So part of making this transition is to begin experimenting with new ways of doing things. In other words, plant seeds of a new story.
The kind of intelligence we need is not data, but narrative. How do you put all these disparate pieces together in a structure that has direction, momentum, purpose? So the question for me is not just do we need a new story, but do we need a new way of telling the story?
There are three stories, actually, that we have to choose from to make sense of our lives, to make sense of our world. The first story is business as usual. All we need to do is grow our economy. Another story, which is seen and accepted as the reality by the scientists, the activists, like lift back the carpet, look under the rug of the business as usual and see what it's costing us. We call that story the Great Unraveling. Unraveling is what biological and ecological and organic systems do as diversity is lost. They shred. That's not the end of the story, because there's another narrative, another lens through which we can choose to see.
and is taking many forms. This third story, a turning. It's got huge evolutionary pressures behind it.
Any species, any life system, develops. Where you start changing the world.
Thank you, Ali.
You're just going to catch up. You've got the wisdom, the understanding, the true intelligence
Why?
To know how to manage that technology without destroying your habitat. So I see this phase that we're in right now, which has come to a head in our generation, is probably inevitable on any planetary system which develops an intelligent, tool-using species. And if it doesn't destroy itself, any species which has come through this phase has got to let go of this egocentric material.
Has a role in this human existence. That's how we survived, and also our ancestors, our parents taught us and are not that we have to be a little bit selfish in order to survive. And that is the power of the old consciousness. The sense of self is a, not only a delusion, but it's a delusion that causes suffering and anxiety. This deluded sense of a separate self is always going to be haunted by the sense of lack, sense of insufficiency, the feeling that something isn't right about me, something is wrong. We misunderstand the problem is outside ourselves. I feel something is wrong, something isn't right. It must be that I don't have enough of this out here, or I have to solve this problem.
Drive of Western society with commodification and consumerism is buy this, get this, own this, and that sense of lack, that sense that you have that something is missing, will disappear. And of course we know
an exile here. A shame the warden won't leave anything for me to examine. Make sure you tell our
there will
host
always
the piety
be something
of Theopolis sends her regards.
It's bottomless. Once you engage in that project, it's like you're digging in one hole and tossing the dirt in another. And you'll be doing that forever.
So what's the solution to this? Is it returning to nature? Well, we can't return to nature because if we really understand it, we've never left it. we don't need to return to nature, but we do need to realize the sense in which we are embedded in nature.
It's a kind of delusion or optical delusion.
Still, the Kauru barbarians advance from the south. Lion-Eye is dead, his legion slaughtered. Should the need arise, we shall retreat through Prisoner's Gate, raising my barricade behind us. But our lord Brutus nears readiness. Foul times demand heroism. The warden will serve as our savior. May he crush the Kauru into the sand with the mighty fists I shall gift to.
That is characterized by interrelationality. We begin to see that, in fact, what I thought was myself was not myself at all.
Central to that is that the Earth is seen as a living system, a living being, where everything we are and can ever be is dependent on this great, verdant, fertile, sensitive, intricately interwoven web of life.
So now we're starting to look through deep time at how this universe is created. I mean, fantastic tools and analysis that we've come up with have shown us a whole different picture of who we are. First of all, that we are intertwined with all and everything. We now know that we are related to all the life that's ever lived. The story of evolution is everybody's autobiography.
Approximately 13.7 billion years ago, the universe exploded into existence. Tremendous burst of pure energy. We come from that original flaring forth of the universe. We come from that original moment, and we are connected to this seamless unfolding process that has taken place over these 13 billion years. From the original fire love, to the galaxy, to the stars, to the planets, to Earth, to oceans, life, consciousness, and humanity. So we are part of an unfolding evolutionary process that includes all the needs of this underway galaxy.
We've been on planet Earth at Cerno for 200,000 years. This is the first one.
Your spirit is the plaything of the ancestors' slave master.
We are all parts of the great circulation that constitutes the Earth and its ecosystems. The air, the water, the food that comes into me and then passes out of me, this is embedded, this is part of this larger circulation. We know on the most basic level that
I cannot carry
the
this.
Air that we breathe, the oxygen in that air, we're dependent upon the plants for that. And likewise, the plant world is dependent upon the carbon dioxide that we breathe out.
One of the ways to understand life is to just look at ourselves, our own body. It is estimated that our body consists of only 10% human cells. The other 90% are other types of organisms, bacteria primarily and virus. So right away, we have to understand that we are not a human being, we're a human community. Without those cells, those so-called non-human cells, we would not be alive. We would perish right away. Our body itself contains this extraordinary message, if you will, of how interdependent we are on the lives of other organisms.
Kandang as samlo jin jo mi ne re dan si sim je samlo jig le jig den chen de de jig dang 아주 좋아미 초야 앞에는 초의 세랑 아니 그야당 다는 우기 교 주제이냐 근데 지금하고 시간을 떼어봐 마도 예수님이야 아니 지 가수에 남균이 planet senator도 진료 지대 난축 심지엔디 living system을 찍이 임버지 마도 앞에 근데 수부르지 마서네 에너지 가스레 야라 젠럽치 속바 찍이 임버지 드레 인두스탄에 아니 아주 드레 인두스탄은 아주 성로 집에는 로미를 차시고 소소를 차시고 있는 뒤 채소기 아니 말라스는 자도 야라 젠티 차시엘 찍이 임버지
In terms of looking at a truth like interdependence, how interrelated everybody's life is, we often just ignore that fact because it's so mind-boggling to think about just, you know, setting foot in one city on this planet. If one stepped onto a subway platform, to even think about there's 500 other feeling, thinking, eating, loving human beings here, we feel like we can't handle that level of awareness. You can instill a view, but then there actually have to be processes like meditation that actually shift the way the mind relates to others. You can't just say a lot about how we're all connected. You have to actually offer tools.
Son, death is welcomed with open arms.
More aware on that subway.
Did you end Brutus' suffering out of avarice or mercy? Only you know the answer to that one.
The warden's finally free of his own prison. Well, since you're so bloody determined to cheat the britches off death, you'd better have this. And when they write the song about you, just be sure to mention that it was Tarkley who taught you everything you know.
Where are you? Are you in game?
No.
Are you in game, man? In game?
Actually, I'm already still signed into LOL.
Huh?
Been signed into LOL for like 24 hours. I never minimized it. I never exited it.
I never saw that.
I didn't
see that. I see nothing.
Do you know that Snoke is Yoda?
What?
Snoke is Yoda.
Oh yeah.
Oh yeah. Snoke is Yoda. Dark side Yoda.
No, Snoke is Mace Windu.
Dear Shabu.
No, dark side Yoda.
You have certainly had your work cut out for you. Yoda. With Lion Eyes Legion.
But that's what happens when you go to the dark side of the Force. You get enhanced.
Complaints.
You get what?
Enhanced.
Is fully aware.
His dark side.
General's fickle nature.
Oh, yeah.
As to your need to accelerate the implantation process, I can recommend a quite simple alteration. Dip the gem in a boiling solution of 6 parts blood and 1 part thormetic sulfite for no more than 13 seconds.
No, have you?
Any longer, and you invite the crystals raw. Once the gem is withdrawn from the solution, you have but a few seconds to install the gem in the prepared flash.
The what?
And close the wound. Should the gem cool too much prior to implantation, it will become inert.
Which drone?
Doesn't look like. Hey, listen.
Trust
if you ever look at Snoke,
bountiful talent of yours,
Shabu. Doesn't have long ears, bro.
It doesn't. They're behind his head.
Bullshit. fucking
They're behind his knees, man. His ears. They're behind his knees. You just can't see them. I'm YouTubing, bro.
You're laughing. Alright, prisoner's gate, bro. Prisoner's gate.
Just click it. Just click it.
Fuck you.
Just click it. Just
I'm
click
not
it.
Clicking that
just
one again.
Click it. Just click
it's
it.
It's the same one.
Just click it. Come on.
Fuck that.
Come on.
Did you work today?
Yeah.
So how can you be pissed already? Oh, before you called me, you were already drinking. Is that what you're doing?
Come on!
What are you doing?
Playing Neverwinter Nights.
What?
Ooh, Aerolith is on. My character's still there. Man, I love this thing. Dun, 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 dun. Dun, 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 dun.
Oh crap.
Server connection fails. What? Why? Oh yeah, my characters are still here. Oh, how cool is that? That's pretty freaking cool. Gonna go troll people in Aerolith?
Huh? Troll people in Aerolith?
Still got Neverwinter Nights?
Yeah, hang on. I think I did.
own way and land, exile.
Man, there's quite a few people here.
Huh?
There's quite a few people here.
Where?
In Aerolith.
Neverwinter. Where are you? Where are you, Neverwinter? You are right here.
I'm in Wharftown.
What?
Wharftown.
Wharftown, ah, yeah, yeah.
Maybe your food is ready
when you're
hungry,
okay?
Okay,
daddy. Wharftown, not Dwarftown.
Yeah, Dwarftown, exactly. That's what I said.
Dwarftown. Dwarftown.
Dwarf. Town.
I'm in Wharftown.
Whoa. Multiplayer. Hello. Access. Brute force. My name is Alicia. The sorceress. Boom. Okay, now what am I going to look up for? I go get. Could not connect to the server. Oh, servers, I'm there already. I'm in Dwarftown too.
I'm 3/4 of the way through the new Expanse book.
Yeah.
It's good. It's a good book.
Okay, I'm in Wharftown. I'm walking very, very slow. That's in the UN. Boom. I'm
3/4 of the way through the new Expanse book.
Neverwinter. Oh, there you are. Got a horse.
Merry Christmas!
Hang on, wait a minute. It's not letting me get it. That's weird.
Hehehehe.